I will have to say that there are probably a few preachers along with myself who would like to meet this brother who keeps cutting down our time and have a long talk with him. It is wonderful to be here. I certainly appreciate the invitation to come out and be a part of this lectureship. I have long loved the work here, the things that have been done. I appreciate Maxie for inviting me, the eldership for their determination to keep this lectureship going as they have. It is a great good in our brotherhood, and I certainly am glad to be a part of it. Every member of the congregation here, you are doing so much, and whoever made the banana pudding today is to be especially commended, aren't they? That's the only dessert I tasted. There are probably others just as good, but that one I remember. When we think of idols and idolatry, there are likely certain very specific matters that come to mind. Perhaps in thinking about idolatry, what comes to mind is the capricious ingratitude of the people of Israel at the foot of Mount Sinai. They, previously having been in Egyptian bondage, had cried out to the Lord for the harshness of what they faced. And God heard their cry. He sent to them Moses, his spokesman, to be a deliverer for them. And Moses, indeed, following the command and will of God, led the people of Israel out of that bondage. God's people had seen God's mighty hand in delivering them with those 10 plagues that were brought against the Egyptians. And then as a final blow to the Egyptians, when the people of Israel walked across the bed of that Red Sea as God had parted the water, they could look behind them and they saw the pursuing armies of Egypt crushed by that water coming back together. Oh, they had seen the power of God. And so soon after, at Mount Sinai, Moses had gone to receive the law of God, part of which would involve worshiping no other god and not making any graven image. The people went to Aaron while Moses was gone and said, "Up, make us gods that will go before us. For as for this Moses, we know not what is become of him." And so Aaron made those idols that they worshiped. Capricious ingratitude on the part of Israel. Or maybe when we think about idolatry, what comes to mind is the corrupting influence that we see of idolatry in the life of Solomon, the son of King David. In 1 Kings chapter 11, we find that despite his great wisdom, Solomon had married many foreign women who worshipped idols, and we read in that text that they had turned his heart away to worship these idols. And Solomon, despite that great wisdom, despite being the king over God's people, despite his great work in building up that temple for the worship of Jehovah, Solomon turned to idolatry. And so, yes, there is that matter of corrupting influence that comes to mind when we think about idolatry. Or maybe, in thinking about idolatry, what comes to your mind is the convenient invention that we see in the life of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat. There we see a man who found himself in a bit of a quandary. Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, is a name that we likely know very well. He was the first king over the northern kingdom, Israel, when God's people divided into 2 kingdoms. And Jeroboam had what he considered a grave problem. Although most of the tribes had followed him in breaking away from that southern kingdom where Rehoboam ruled, Jeroboam just knew these people are going to want to go to Jerusalem, and they're going to want to worship God there. And if they go to Jerusalem to worship God there, they're going to turn back to Rehoboam. They're going to turn away from me. Perhaps they will even come and kill me. He had a plan. In the book of 1 Kings chapter 12, beginning with verse 28, we read that plan of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat. At least we see the beginning of his plan. We read that the king took counsel and he made 2 calves of gold. And he said to the people, "It is too much for you to go up to Jerusalem. Behold thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt." And he set the one in Bethel and the other he set in Dan. Jeroboam's idols were the beginning, if you will forgive me, of his church growth strategy. give the people what they want, and they will never leave you. And so maybe when we think about idolatry, it is that convenient invention. Or perhaps, in thinking of idolatry, what comes to your mind is the commercial industry that is found in the book of Acts, chapter 19. There we read of a man named Demetrius. He was a silversmith in the city of Ephesus. Now, the Apostle Paul had been doing some teaching in that city for quite some time. And as Paul had been teaching and preaching, souls were brought to Christ. People were turning from the pagan rule of the land around them, and they turned from the idolatry. They began to serve the living God. That was a problem for Demetrius, because after all, as a silversmith, he made the idols that the people would go out and buy and worship. And so he gathered others of like craft together, and he began to complain to them, these people, by their teaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ, their preaching of Jesus, they are stealing our livelihood. Oh yes, they're harming the worship of idolatry in general, but our wealth, our livelihood is threatened. And so they brought together that mob, crying out, great is Diana of the Ephesians. Commercial industry. And I suppose it is easy for us, given our perspective, to think of idolatry as the capricious ingratitude, rather, of the people of Israel, the corrupting influence in the life of Solomon, the convenient invention in Jeroboam the son of Nebat, the commercial industry of Demetrius and others like him. And if that is all that we think about idolatry, that it was something back then with those people, we are setting ourselves for a fall. Because it will then be so easy for us to fall into that trap that says, I have nothing to fear from idolatry. There are no golden calves on my horizon. I'm not about to fall down and begin to serve and worship some wooden totem that really can do nothing. I'm not in danger of this sin of idolatry. We would do well to be cautious. It was December 31st, 1967. I'm risking a great deal by bringing this up in this place at this time, but I'll do it anyway. The Dallas Cowboys had gone to Green Bay as upstarts seeking their first NFL title. Just 1 year before, the Cowboys had gone to Green Bay looking for the championship then, and they had seen their hopes of that title dissolve when Don Meredith's potential game-winning touchdown was intercepted in the end zone. But it was a new year, and the Green Bay Packers were an older team now. They had struggled during the regular season. It was quite possible the Cowboys could win the NFL title. But the Packers had something on their side. Number one, they were playing on their field. Number two, they were entering this contest as two-time defending NFL champions, and they were looking to make it three consecutive championships. Here's the dangerous part for me. I'm sorry to say that Dallas lost that football game. It was a hard-fought game. 21-17 was the final score. But that is not what made that game so interesting. Fans of the game of football call that particular championship game the Ice Bowl. And with good reason. When the Dallas Cowboys woke up that brisk winter morning, they woke up to hear first that it was 19 degrees below zero. It was not much warmer by game time. In fact, the official game temperature was 13 degrees below zero with a wind chill factor of minus 48. I cannot imagine walking across a parking lot in such temperatures, much less playing a game of football, but that is what they did. And we might think that in conditions so harsh and so terrible, there would be so many people who would say, I think I'll just stay home today. I'm not going to go out and watch this football game. Not those fans. The game was a sellout. There were 50,861 fans on hand to watch what would later be called the most memorable football game of the century. And it is hard for us not to wonder just how many there are who would go and watch a football game such as that, or some other event and conditions that would be just as harsh, who would then turn around and neglect their attendance in the worship of the saints because there is some deacon somewhere who does not keep the thermostat turned just where they want it to be. You know who I'm talking about. Or the seats are not padded enough. Or dare I say it, the preacher preaches too long. We have our idols, don't we? So what is it for us? Is it a football game? Is it golf? Is it our work? Is it money and things? Have we followed after the idol of our age? Oh, friends, before we shrug off a lesson about idolatry, let us take a close look at our own heart and our own lives. Let us examine ourselves. We need to ask ourselves, and we need to be honest when we answer. Have I taken God from His rightful place in my life? And have I replaced Him with something or some idea instead? Make no mistake about it. To do so is utter folly. And so we turn in our Bible to Psalm 115, beginning with verse 4. Psalm 115, verse 4, beginning, we find these great words that serve as a springboard of sorts, telling us of idolatry. Their idols are silver and gold, the work of men's hands. They have mouths, but they do not speak. They have eyes, but they do not see. Ears have they, but they cannot hear. Noses have they, but they smell not. They have hands, but they handle not. Feet have they, but they walk not. Neither speak they through their throat. We find a companion passage in Psalm 135, verses 15 through 17. The very same thoughts presented to us. Idols can do nothing. And so our topic this afternoon is this very idea, the folly of idolatry. And as we consider this topic, let us just ask this question. What is it that makes idols so foolish? To answer that question, friends, is to look at two sides of the same coin. First, we look at the idols, then we look at the true and living God. A close look at both will show us the foolishness of idolatry, and so let us do that this afternoon. Number one, idolatry is foolish because idols have no power. Isn't that what we find time and again in the Scripture? Looking at idolatry, looking at the worship of idols, we find of them that, number one, they can be stolen. Isn't that what we see in Genesis chapter 31? There we read of the man Jacob, the son of Isaac, the grandson of Abraham. Jacob had been working for his uncle Laban, but he was ready to leave. In fact, he got his wives, Leah and Rachel, together to explain to them why he needed to leave their father Laban. And as he spoke to them in Genesis chapter 31, verse 17, he explained to Leah and Rachel, "Your father Laban has changed my wages 10 times. That is, he has kept on changing my wages." And so Jacob took his family, along with his wealth, and he left Laban. Now he did this while Laban was off elsewhere, shearing his sheep. But Jacob did not know it. But his wife Rachel had taken Laban, her father's, teraphim, household images or idols or household gods that would have been used in the worship. She had taken her father's idols, and Jacob did not know a thing about this. But Laban, when Laban found out Jacob had left, he was furious. He pursued after him and finally overtook him. And in Genesis chapter 31, verses 26 through 30, we find out exactly what Laban had to say to Jacob. He said, "Why did you leave without saying goodbye? Why did you take my daughters and their families without saying anything?" And finally he said, "Yet wherefore hast thou stolen my gods?" Jacob had no idea about the stolen teraphim. And Laban never found out that Rachel had taken them. But can you imagine to be in that position? To look another man in the eye and say, "How dare you steal my God?" the folly of idolatry. They can be stolen, whisked away in the dead of night, never to be seen again. Number two, the folly of idolatry is that they can be severed, that is, cut off. That is our finding in 1 Samuel chapter 5. Here we find that amazing account in which the Ark of the Covenant, the Ark of God, had been placed in a temple dedicated to the worship of the Philistine idol Dagon. And now Dagon, depending on which authority we read, was either a fish god based upon the word Dag or a grain god, Dagan. And there are those who have discussed the differences in the two. Suffice it to say, this was an idol worshipped by the Philistines. In the previous chapter, 1 Samuel chapter 4, we read about how the Ark of God had been taken. It was in that terrible battle in which God's judgment against the sons of Eli had been brought to bear. And so the Ark of God was taken in that battle. When Eli heard of this, remember, he fell and he died on the spot. But what do you do when you defeat the Israelites in battle, when you overcome them, and suddenly you have this Ark of God that they were carrying around as if it were an idol? And friends, I suggest to you, in many ways at that point it had become something of an idol to the people of Israel anyway, the way they carried it into that battle. But what do you do with such an object when you win it in battle? The Philistines had no such questions. They went to Ashdod and they took the Ark of God and put it in the temple dedicated to the worship of their idol Dagon, and put it before Dagon. Now get that picture in your mind. The Ark of God captured, put in this building dedicated to the worship of an idol before this idol looming over it. Now look at 1 Samuel 5 and verse 3. And when they of Ashdod rose early on the morrow, behold, Dagon was fallen in his face upon the earth before the ark of the Lord. And they took Dagon and set him in his place again. Now let that little mental picture of yours roll forward. Imagine what is happening. This idol before which the ark of God had been placed now has fallen prostrate on the ground before the ark of God. And those priests entered their temple to see their idol on its face before the Ark of the Covenant. And they had the unenviable task of having to then push their idol back into its place. Now read the next verse, verse 4. The next day, when they rose early on the morrow morning, behold, Dagon was fallen upon his face to the ground before the Ark of the Lord. Does it sound familiar? And the head of Dagon and both the hands, palms of his hands, were cut off upon the threshold. Only the stump of Dagon was left to him. Go back to your mental image. Those priests who had to put their idol back in its place now come in and find not only their idol has fallen on its face before the ark of the Lord, but their idol has now lost its head and its hands. It was severed. What is the foolishness? The folly of idolatry? They can be severed. They can be cut off. They can be ground up. They can be destroyed. Number three, considering the folly of idolatry, looking at the idols themselves, they are foolish because they can be sorted. This point comes to us from 1 Kings chapter 20. This morning, Brother Harp did a marvelous job taking us to that chapter to look at 1 Kings chapter 20. There we read of that king of Syria, Ben-Hadad, who had been fighting against the northern kingdom of Israel, and Ben-Hadad thought he had an invincible army. But God delivered the people of Israel from King Ben-Hadad. And in 1 Kings chapter 20 and verse 21, we read that the king of Israel slew the Syrians with a great slaughter. Whatever Ben-Hadad's plans had been, these were not what he was counting on. He did not know what to do. He did not know what had gone wrong, but he got some advice. 1 Kings chapter 20, verse 23, we find these words that the servants of the king of Syria said to him, "Their gods are the gods of the hills. Therefore, they were stronger than we, but let us fight against them in the plain, and surely we shall be stronger than they." They were trying to sort the God of heaven, to divide him into a convenient little box in which they could place him on a shelf and say, this is his sphere of influence, and outside of this, he can do nothing. Ben-Hadad listened to them. A new battle then was arranged. Ben-Hadad gathered a tremendous army to battle the much smaller army of the people of Israel. In fact, 1 Kings chapter 20, verse 27 presents to us one of those pictures in Scripture that should stick in our mind. Think about this as you consider the eventual happenings in this battle. 1 Kings 20, verse 27, the children of Israel were pitched before them as two little flocks of kids. And the Syrians filled the country. This didn't look like a fair fight. This looked like one of those times in which the children of Israel were going to see themselves utterly defeated, because after all, they were so badly outnumbered. Someone forgot to count God. We continue reading 1 Kings chapter 20, verse 29. They pitched one over against another 7 days. And so it was that in the seventh day the battle was joined, and the children of Israel slew of the Syrians 100,000 footmen in one day. Two little flocks of kids. The Syrians filled the country, and the two little flocks of kids defeated the vast army before them. Oh, the people of Syria learned an important lesson that day. Jehovah, the God of heaven and earth, cannot be sorted into some compartment and laid aside. They're thinking Israel's God will help them in the hills, but not in the plains, because he is a God of the hills. And they were as wrong as they could be, friends. There we see the folly of idolatry. But now flip the coin. Having seen the folly of idolatry as it pertains to the idols themselves, now let us realize idolatry is also foolish, because there is a true and living God. When we take the time to contrast the God of heaven against any of the various idols that the world has engraved, engineered, or otherwise engendered, we find a gaping chasm in their nature and abilities. Oh, even with all of the collective imagination of mankind as the fires to stoke the idea of the idols, they cannot begin to compare with the God of heaven. Friends, let us realize we cannot begin to scratch the surface of the nature and character of God in our time today. If we took every lecture from this point until the day is over, we still would not begin to see all that God is. But we must look at some. A survey then of sorts. We're not even going to look at the omni characteristics of God, for which we could speak for days. His omnipotence, his omniscience, his omnipresence. What is it about the God of heaven that causes us to see the utter foolishness of idolatry? Number one, God is eternal. Friends, there never has been a time when God was not. He did not come into being, and he will not one day cease to be. He is. And so we read those words in Psalm 90, beginning with verse 1. Those beautiful words, Psalm 90, verse 1, beginning, Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, before you had formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. He is eternal. No wonder then we turn to Isaiah chapter 57, verse 15, and we find that beautiful nomenclature of the God of heaven. For thus saith the high and lofty one that inhabiteth eternity. What comfort we have, knowing that we do not have to consider some power greater than God that brought him into existence, because there is none greater. He was not brought into existence. He exists. He is. Nor do we have to contemplate some fiery Ragnarok in which the God of heaven will be defeated and cease to be, because it will not happen. He will always be. He is eternal. Number two, God is holy. Oh, of course, when we mention this point, our minds are immediately turned to Isaiah chapter 6, verse 3. I truly cannot think of a better single passage to bring out to our heart and our mind that holiness of God. As Isaiah saw that vision of the Lord on his throne and the seraphim were there. And we read those words in Isaiah chapter 6, verse 3 regarding those seraphim, that one cried out to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." Oh, then we turn in our Bible to Revelation chapter 4 and verse 8. We read of another man in another vision. John, writing down those things that he was privileged to see, saw that door open into heaven, and there he saw the throne of God and the Lord on his throne. And there were those, King James Version calls them beasts, living creatures around the throne. Revelation 4 verse 8, "And the four living creatures had each of them six wings about him, and they were full of eyes within and without, and they rest not day and night, saying, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, the whole earth is full of his glory. He is the one who was and who is to come. The God of heaven is not just holy. He is holy, holy, holy. And that holiness should have a profound impact upon my life and yours. He is holy, therefore we should be holy." 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 15 and 16. He is holy, therefore when we come together to worship him, we stand in awe of him. We revere him. We show him the respect that is due his name, because our God is holy. Number three, idols are foolish because God is just. As we consider this idea of God and how he shows us the folly of idolatry, his justice must come into the picture, because as we consider the idols that men and women have created for themselves, we find myths and legends in which those so-called gods were so partial in their activities among mankind. Oh, those stories and legends tell of these idols who, at a moment's notice, on every whim and fancy, their favors would change from one person to the next, to the next. Oh, not so with the God of heaven. In Acts chapter 10, beginning with verse 34, Peter at the household of Cornelius had this to say. Peter opened his mouth and said, "Of a truth, I perceive that God is no respecter of persons. But in every nation, he who feareth him and worketh righteousness is accepted with him." Oh, he is just. The Bible tells us that we can count upon God to exercise justice. It is one of his characteristics. It is part of who he is. He is just. And number four, concerning God, he is merciful. When we, by our sin, separate ourselves from God, because after all, he is holy, and our sin takes us outside the realm of that holiness. When we separate ourselves from him by that sin, his justice then speaks up and requires that there be punishment for sin, that you and I pay the price for what we have done. Then we read 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 3. Brother, I don't know if you looked at my notes before you led that song, but I'm glad you led it. "Blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ." And as we read these words, we come to that phrase, "the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort." His justice calls out that the price be paid, and his mercy means that God, seeing the lost state of mankind, having compassion on us, determined that something be done to help us. And then we see number five, the love of God. And of course, we must mention this. 1 John chapter 4, beginning with verse 7. Our young people start memorizing it early, and I'm glad. "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. And everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. Oh, the breadth of the love of God. Again, it is something we could study for days without plumbing the depths of it. But we know what it prompted him to do. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Oh, as we open our Bibles, we read in the pages of Scripture how mankind, by our own sin, have separated ourselves from God, and how God in his justice said the price must be paid, but in his mercy he determined something would be done to save us, and in his love he sent his only begotten Son to take away our sin by his blood. Oh, how great the forgiveness of God. And so as we see the nature, the character of God, it is no wonder that we find time and again in Scripture those earnest warnings against idolatry. No wonder we turn in the book of Psalms now to Psalm 135, verses 15 through 17, a sister passage, a companion passage, if you will, to that which we read just a few moments ago from Psalm 115. Psalm 135, beginning with verse 15, "The idols of the heathen are silver and gold, the work of men's hands. They have mouths, but they do not speak. They have eyes, but they do not see. They have ears, but they do not hear. Neither is there any breath in their mouths." The folly of idolatry. Idols are impotent objects and ideas that we have turned to serve in place of the true and living God. But what idols are they that we serve? We see those today who serve the idol of pleasure, seeking those things that feel good, those things that I like, those things that we would call a good experience. And friends, normally when we think of the idol of pleasure, what we think about are the sins of the flesh. But friends, there are some things that in and of themselves would not be wrong. They would not be sinful, and yet we can create of them an idol. Don't we see it all the time in the area of entertainment? Some things that would not be wrong, but before long, we're going to have Super Bowl Sunday, aren't we? Where will we be on that Sunday evening? Oh, let us not fall for the idol of pleasure. Others perhaps have given in to the idol of materialism. Let's face it, we live in a day and age in which it seems that every thought of every man's heart is to gain more and more continually. Advertisers on television tell us everything we need. They start with our children when they're small, making our children think there are more things that they need. There are more toys that they would like to have, more games to play. And we get so caught up in it that we turn from the God of heaven to get more and more. There are those today who also serve the idol of intellectual conformity. Someone says, "What is that?" I will give you an example. A woman by the name of Pamela Winnick was labeled some years ago as a fanatic and a member of the religious right. It was 5 years ago she had published an article about a man named Michael Behe. Now, he is a scientist who favors what is being called intelligent design. That is, that he can look at the world around him and see such complexity, such design in nature, that there must be some designer. Well, Miss Winnick wrote that article about him, and suddenly everyone in the world of journalism and science turned on her and called her those nasty names. Religious right indeed. Miss Winnick considers herself, she said, a non-religious Jewish Democrat. But here's what she said, and I believe at least in this she's right. "The scientific community cannot bear being challenged even when they are patently wrong. They have come to see themselves as gods and don't like anyone challenging them." The idol of intellectual conformity. You believe what we believe, or we're going to cut you out, we're not going to listen to you, and we'll tell everyone that your voice should not be heard. Others serve the idol of relativism. This one is a particular danger, I believe, for us today. We live in a postmodern world. And in this postmodern world, we have determined that right and wrong are as variable as the winds that blow. After all, let's just see how I feel, and that's going to become right for me, and how you feel is right for you. And we may be on opposite ends of the spectrum in direct disagreement, but after all, we can both be right. To see the fallacy, consider this. One day, a first grader brought his new puppy to school for show and tell. As you can very well imagine, all of the children there just could not make enough of a fuss over that new puppy. And everything went well until one child asked that fateful question, "Is it a boy or a girl?" Well, the little boy did not know. It was his new puppy. No one had informed him of this important piece of information. So the children began a lively debate, trying to decide how they could tell if it was a girl or a boy. Finally, one girl got the teacher's attention. She said, "I know how we can tell if it's a girl or a boy." Oh, that teacher was scared to death at that point. She said, "How?" The girl said, "We can vote on it." That's what we've done, isn't it? Abortion? Let's vote on it. Let's see what most people say and determine whether or not we should say it is legal or illegal. Homosexuality, let's just put our finger to the wind. Let's see where public opinion lies on this, and then we will determine what we're going to do. We have our idols, don't we? The list could go on and on, but they are folly. They cannot speak, they cannot hear, and they can act neither for good nor for evil. And so now let us turn back in our Bible to the book of Psalms. Psalm 100, verse 3 beginning. What do we learn about idolatry? What should our stance be? Know ye that the Lord, He is God. It is He that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are His people, the sheep of His pasture. Enter into His gates with thanksgiving and into His courts with praise. Be thankful unto Him and bless His name. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting. And His truth endureth to all generations.